This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. A class action, class suit, or representative action is a type of lawsuit where one of the parties is a group of people who are represented collectively by a member of that group. The class action originated in the United States and is still predominantly a U.S. phenomenon, but several European countries with civil law have made changes in recent years to allow consumer organizations to bring claims on behalf of consumers. Contents 1 Description 2 History 21 Class actions in English courts 22 Early class actions in the United States 23 1966 revisions to Rule 23 and the birth of the modern class action 3 Modern class actions in the United States 31 Federal courts 311 Jurisdiction 312 Class certification under Rule 23313 Notice and settlement 32 State courts 33 Statistics 4 Advantages 5 Criticisms 6 Ethics 7 Defendant Class Action 8 Mass Actions 9 Class Actions Outside the United States 91 Argentina 92 Australia and New Zealand 93 Austria 94 Canada 95 Chile 96 France 97 Germany 98 Italy 99 India 910 Netherlands 911 Spain 912 Switzerland 913 United Kingdom 10 See also 11 Notes 12 External links 121 U.S. Law 122 EU Law 123 Proposals to expand European class action law. Description: in a typical class action, a plaintiff sues a defendant or a number of defendants on behalf of a group, or class, of absent parties. This differs from a traditional lawsuit, where one party sues another party for redress of a wrong, and all of the parties are present in court. Although standards differ between states and countries, class actions are most common where the allegations involve a large number of people who have been injured by the same defendant in the same way. Instead of each injured person bringing their own lawsuit, the class action allows all the claims of all class members, whether they know they have been injured or not, to be resolved in a single proceeding history. Class actions in English courts. The antecedent of the class action was what modern observers call group litigation, which appears to have been quite common in medieval England from about 1200 onward. 38 These lawsuits involved groups of people either suing or being sued in actions at common law. These groups were usually based on existing societal structures like villages, towns, parishes, and guilds. Unlike modern courts, the medieval English courts did not question the right of the actual plaintiffs to sue on behalf of a group or a few representatives to defend an entire group. 38-40 From 1400 to 1700, group litigation gradually switched from being the norm in England to the exception. 100 The development of the concept of the corporation led to the wealthy supporters of the corporate form becoming suspicious of all unincorporated legal entities, which in turn led to the modern concept of the unincorporated or voluntary association. 124-25 The tumultuous history of the Wars of the Roses and then the Star Chamber resulted in periods during which the common law courts were frequently paralyzed, and out of the confusion the Court of Chancery emerged with exclusive jurisdiction over group litigation. 125-32 By 1850, Parliament had enacted several statutes on a case-by-case basis to deal with issues regularly faced by certain types of organizations, like joint stock companies, and with the impetus for most types of group litigation removed, it went into a steep decline in English jurisprudence from which it never recovered. 210-12 It was further weakened by the fact that equity pleading in general was falling into disfavor, which culminated in the Judicature Acts of 1874 and 1875-210-12 Group litigation was essentially dead in England after 1850. Early class actions in the United States. Class actions survived in the United States thanks to the influence of Supreme Court Associate Justice Joseph Story, who imported it into U.S. law through summary discussions in his two equity treatises as well as his opinion in West v. Randall 1820-219-20. However, Story did not necessarily endorse class actions, because he could not conceive of a modern function or a coherent theory for representative litigation. 219-20 The oldest predecessor to the class action rule in the United States was Equity Rule 48, promulgated in 1833, which allowed for representative suits lawsuits in situations where there were too many individual parties, which now forms the first requirement for class action litigation. Numerosity, however, this rule did not allow such suits to bind similarly situated absent parties, which rendered the rule ineffective. 221 Within 10 years, the Supreme Court interpreted Rule 48 in such a way so that it could apply to absent parties under certain circumstances, but only by ignoring the plain meaning of the rule. 221-22 In the early 20th century, Equity Rule 48 was replaced with Equity Rule 38 as part of a major restructuring of the equity rules, and when federal courts merged their legal and equitable procedural systems in 1938, Equity Rule 38 became Rule 23 of the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure. 1966 Revisions to Rule 23 and the birth of the modern class action. A major revision of the FRCP in 1966 radically transformed Rule 23, made the opt-out class action the standard option, and gave birth to the modern class action. Entire treatises have been written since to summarize the huge mass of law that sprang up from the 1966 revision of Rule 23-229. Just as medieval group litigation bound all members of the group regardless of whether they all actually appeared in court, the modern class action binds all members of the class, except for those who choose to opt out if the rules permit them to do so. The advisory committee that drafted the new Rule 23 in the mid-1960s was influenced by two major developments. First was the suggestion of Harry Calvin Jr. and Maurice Rosenfield in 1941 that class action litigation by individual shareholders on behalf of all shareholders of a company could effectively supplement direct government regulation of securities markets and other similar markets. 232 The second development was the rise of the African American civil rights movement, environmentalism and consumerism. 240-44 The groups behind these movements, as well as many others in the 1960s, 1970s and 1980s, all turned to class actions as a means for achieving their goals. For example, a 1978 environmental law treatise reprinted the entire text of Rule 23 and mentioned class actions 14 times in its index, 244-45. Businesses targeted by class actions for inflicting massive aggregate harm have sought ways to avoid class actions altogether. In the 1990s, the U.S. Supreme Court issued a number of decisions which strengthened the federal policy favoring arbitration. In response, lawyers have added provisions to consumer contracts of adhesion called collective action waivers, which prohibit those signing the contracts from bringing class action suits. In 2011, the U.S. Supreme Court ruled in a 5-4 decision in it. In the United States federal courts, class actions are governed by Federal Rules of Civil Procedure Rule 23 and 28 U.S.C.A. Section. Original jurisdiction over any civil action where the amount in controversy exceeds $5 million and any member of a class of plaintiffs is a citizen of a state different from any defendant, or any member of a class of plaintiffs is a foreign state or a citizen or subject of a foreign state and any defendant is a citizen of a state, or any member of a class of plaintiffs is a citizen of a state and any defendant is a foreign state or a citizen or subject of a foreign state. Nationwide plaintiff classes are possible, but such suits must have a commonality of issues across state lines. This may be difficult if the civil law in the various states lack significant commonalities. Large class actions brought in federal court frequently are consolidated for pre-trial purposes through the device of multi-district litigation, MDL. It is also possible to bring class actions under state law, and in some cases the court may extend its jurisdiction to all the members of the class, including out of state or even internationally, as the key element is the jurisdiction that the court has over the defendant class certification under Rule 23. This section needs expansion with, needs discussion of 23B class action types. You can help by adding to it May 2015 for the case to proceed as a class action and bind absent class members. The court must certify the class under Rule 23 on a motion from the party wishing to proceed on a class basis. For a class to be certified, the moving party must meet all of the criteria listed under Rule 23A, and at least one of the criteria listed under Rule 23B. The 23A criteria are referred to as numerosity, commonality, typicality, and adequacy. Numerosity refers to the number of people in the class to be certified. The class has to have enough members that simply adding each of them as a named party to the lawsuit would be impractical. There is no bright line rule to determine numerosity, but classes with hundreds of members are generally deemed to be sufficiently numerous to satisfy commonality. There must be a common question of law and fact such that determination of its truth or falsity will resolve an issue that is central to the validity of each one of the claims in one stroke. The typicality requirement ensures that the claims or defenses of the named plaintiff are typical of those of everyone else in the class. Finally, adequacy requirement states that the named plaintiff must fairly and adequately represent the interests of the absent class members. Notice and settlement. This section needs expansion with, this needs much more detail on. Notice and on settlement procedures. You can help by adding to it May 2015 due process requires in most cases that notice describing the class action be sent, published, or broadcast to class members as part of this notice procedure. There may have to be several notices. First, a notice giving class members the opportunity to opt out of the class, i.e. if individuals wish to proceed with their own litigation they are entitled to do so, only to the extent that they give timely notice to the class counsel or the court that they are opting out. Second, if there is a settlement proposal, the court will usually direct the class counsel to send a settlement notice to all the members of the certified class, informing them of the details of the proposed settlement. State courts since 1938, many states have adopted rules similar to the FRCP. However, some states, like California, have civil procedure systems, which deviate significantly from the federal rules. The California codes provide for four separate types of class actions as a result. There are two separate treatises devoted solely to the complex topic of California class actions. Some states, such as Virginia, do not provide for any class actions, while others, such as New York, limit the types of claims that may be brought as class actions. In 2013, several class action lawsuits have been filed under both the Federal Fair Debt Collection Practices Act and similar Michigan state laws against some of Michigan's largest medical providers and collection agencies, which may have a dramatic impact on the collection of unpaid medical bills and the collection industry as a whole. Statistics as of 2010, there was no publicly maintained list of non-securities class action settlements, although a securities class action database exists in the Stanford Law School Securities Class Action Clearinghouse, and several for-profit companies maintain lists of the securities settlements. One study of federal settlements required the researcher to manually search databases of lawsuits for the relevant records. Although state class actions were not included due to the difficulty in gathering the information, another source of data is U.S. Bureau of Justice Statistics Civil Justice Survey of State Courts, which in 2009 was published with an overview of 2005 statistics. Advantages. Proponents of class actions state that they offer a number of advantages because they aggregate a large number of individualized claims into one representational lawsuit. First, aggregation can increase the efficiency of the legal process, and lower the costs of litigation in cases with common questions of law and fact. Aggregation of claims into a class action may avoid the necessity of repeating days of the same witnesses, exhibits and issues from trial to trial. Jenkins v. Raymark Indus Inc., 782 F. 2d 468, 473 5th, CIR 1986. Granting certification of a class action involving asbestos. Second, a class action may overcome the problem that small recoveries do not provide the incentive for any individual to bring a solo action prosecuting his or her rights. Amcham Prods, Inc. v. Windsor, 521 U.S. 591, 617, 1997. Quoting Mace v. Van Roo Credit Corp., 109 F. 3d 388, 344 7th, CIR 1997. A class action solves this problem by aggregating the relatively paltry potential recoveries into something worth someone's, usually an attorney's, labor. Amcham Prods, Inc., 521 U.S. at 617. Quoting Mace, 109 F. 3d at 344. In other words, a class action ensures that a defendant who engages in widespread harm in tort proximately flowing from the failure to report the suspected injuries previously. Many physicians had remained reluctant to report cases of apparent child abuse, despite existing law that required it. Fourth, in limited fund cases, a class action ensures that all plaintiffs receive relief and that early filing plaintiffs do not raid the fund, i.e., the defendant of all its assets before other plaintiffs may be compensated. See Ortiz v. Fiberboard Corp., 527 U.S. 815-1999. A class action in such a situation centralizes all claims into one venue where a court can equitably divide the assets amongst all the plaintiffs if they win the case. Finally, a class action avoids the situation where different court rulings could create incompatible standards of conduct for the defendant to follow. See Fed R. Civ. P. 23b1a. For example, a court might certify a case for class treatment where a number of individual bondholders sue to determine whether they may convert their bonds to common stock, refusing to litigate the case in one trial could result in different outcomes and inconsistent standards of conduct for the defendant corporation. Thus, courts will generally allow a class action in such a situation. See, e.g., Van Gemert v. Boeing Co., 259 F. Sup. 125 SDNY 1966. Whether a class action is superior to individual litigation depends on the case and is determined by the judge's ruling on a motion for class certification. The Advisory Committee Note to Rule 23, for example, states that mass torts are ordinarily not appropriate for class treatment. Class treatment may not improve the efficiency of a mass tort because the claims frequently involve individualized issues of law and fact that will have to be retried on an individual basis. See Costano v. M. Tobacco Co., 84 F3D 734 5th, CIR 1996. Rejecting nationwide class action against tobacco companies, mass torts also involve high individual damage awards. Thus, the absence of class treatment will not impede the ability of individual claimants to seek justice. See other cases, however, may be more conducive to class treatment. The preamble to the Class Action Fairness Act of 2005, passed by the United States Congress, found, class action lawsuits are an important and valuable part of the legal system when they permit the fair and efficient resolution of legitimate claims of numerous parties by allowing the claims to be aggregated into a single action against a defendant that has allegedly caused harm. Criticisms. There are several criticisms of class actions. The preamble to the Class Action Fairness Act stated that some abusive class actions harmed class members with legitimate claims and defendants that have acted responsibly, adversely affected interstate commerce, and undermined public respect for the country's judicial system. Class members often receive little or no benefit from class actions. Examples cited for this include large fees for the attorneys, while leaving class members with coupons or other awards of little or no value. Unjustified awards are made to certain plaintiffs at the expense of other class members, and confusing notices are published that prevent class members from being able to fully understand and effectively exercise their rights. For example, in the United States, class lawsuits sometimes bind all class members with a low settlement. These coupon settlements, which usually allow the plaintiffs to receive a small benefit such as a small check or a coupon for future services or products with the defendant company, are a way for a defendant to forestall major liability by precluding a large number of people from litigating their claims separately to recover reasonable compensation for the damages. However, existing law requires judicial approval of all class action settlements, and in most cases class members are given a chance to opt out of class settlement, though class members, despite opt-out notices, may be unaware of their right to opt out because they did not receive the notice, did not read it, or did not understand it. The Class Action Fairness Act of 2005 addresses these concerns. Coupon settlements may be scrutinized by an independent expert before judicial approval in order to ensure that the settlement will be of value to the class members. 28 U.S.C.A. 1712d. Further, if the action provides for settlement in coupons, the portion of any attorney's fee award to class counsel that is attributable to the award of the coupons shall be based on the value to class members of the coupons that are redeemed. 28 U.S.C.A. 1712a. Ethics. Class action cases present significant ethical challenges. Defendants can hold reverse auctions, and any of several parties can engage in collusive settlement discussions. Subclasses may have interests that diverge greatly from the class, but may be treated the same. Proposed settlements could offer some groups, such as former customers, much greater benefits than others. In one paper presented at an ABA conference on class actions in 2007, authors commented that competing cases can also provide opportunities for collusive settlement discussions and reverse auctions by defendants anxious to resolve their new exposure at the most economic cost. Defendant class action. Although normally plaintiffs are the class, defendant class actions are also possible. For example, in 2005, the Roman Catholic Archdiocese of Portland in Oregon was sued as part of the Catholic priest sex abuse scandal. All parishioners of the archdiocese's churches were cited as a defendant class. This was done to include their assets. Local churches in any settlement where both the plaintiffs and the defendants have been organized into court-approved classes. The action is called a bilateral class action. Mass actions. In a class action, the plaintiff seeks court approval to litigate on behalf of a group of Similarly situated persons, not every plaintiff looks for, or could obtain, such approval as a procedural alternative. Plaintiff's counsel may attempt to sign up every similarly situated person that counsel can find as a client. Plaintiff's counsel can then join the claims of all of these persons in one complaint, a so-called mass action, hoping to have the same efficiencies and economic leverage as if a class had been certified. Because mass actions operate outside the detailed procedures laid out for class actions, they can pose special difficulties for both plaintiffs, defendants, and the court. For example, settlement of class actions follows a predictable path of negotiation with class counsel and representatives, court scrutiny, and notice. There may not be a way to uniformly settle all of the many claims brought via a mass action. Some states permit plaintiffs' counsel to settle for all the mass action plaintiffs according to a majority vote. For example, other states, such as New Jersey, require each plaintiff to approve the settlement of that plaintiff's own individual claims. Class actions outside the United States. Argentina class actions were recognized in Halabi leading case Supreme Court, 2009. Australia and New Zealand class actions became part of the Australian legal landscape only when the Federal Parliament amended the Federal Court of Australia Act 1, the FCAA, in 1992 to introduce the representative proceedings, the equivalent of the American class actions. Likewise, class actions appeared slowly in New Zealand legal system. However, a group can bring litigation through the action of a representative under the High Court rules, which provide that one or a multitude of persons may sue on behalf of, or for the benefit of, all persons with the same interest in the subject matter of a proceeding. The presence and expansion of litigation funders have been playing a significant role in the emergence of class actions in New Zealand. For example, the Fair Play on Fees proceedings in relation to penalty fees charged by banks was funded by Litigation Lending Services LLS, a company specializing in the funding and management of litigation in Australia and New Zealand. It was the biggest class action suit in New Zealand history. Austria, the Austrian Code of Civil Procedure Zivilprozessordnung. Among the class, this technique, soon labeled as class action Austrian style, allows for a significant reduction of overall costs. The Austrian Supreme Court, in a recent judgment, has confirmed the legal admissibility of these lawsuits under the condition that all claims are essentially based on the same grounds. The Austrian Parliament has unanimously requested the Austrian Federal Minister for Justice to examine the possibility of new legislation providing for a cost-effective and appropriate way to deal with mass claims, together with the Austrian Ministry for Social Security, Generations and Consumer Protection. The Justice Ministry opened the discussion with a conference held in Vienna in June 2005 with the aid of a group of experts from many fields. The Justice Ministry began drafting the new law in September 2005 with the individual positions varying greatly. A political consensus could not be reached. Canada provincial laws in Canada allow class actions. All provinces permit plaintiff classes and some permit defendant classes. Quebec was the first province to enact class proceedings legislation in 1978. Ontario was next with the Class Proceedings Act, 1992. As of 2008, 9 of 10 provinces have enacted comprehensive class actions legislation. In Prince Edward Island, where no comprehensive legislation exists, following the decision of the Supreme Court of Canada in Western Canadian Shopping Centres Inc. v. Dutton, 2534 Seychelles rupees, class actions may be advanced. Under a local rule of court, the Federal Court of Canada permits class actions under Part 5(1) of the Federal Courts Rules legislation in Saskatchewan, Manitoba, Ontario, and Nova Scotia. Expressly or by judicial opinion have been read to allow for what are informally known as national opt-out class actions, whereby residents of other provinces may be included in the class definition and potentially be bound by the court's judgment on common issues unless they opt out in a prescribed manner and time. Court rulings have determined that this permits a court in one province to include residents of other provinces in the class action on an opt-out basis. Recent judicial opinions have indicated that provincial legislative national opt-out powers should not be exercised to interfere with the ability of another province to certify a parallel class action for residents of other provinces. The first court to certify will generally exclude residents of provinces whose courts have certified a parallel class action. However, in the Vioxx litigation, two provincial courts recently certified overlapping class actions, whereby Canadian residents are class members in two class actions in two provinces. Both decisions are under appeal. The largest class action suit to date in Canada was settled in 2005 after Nora Bernard initiated efforts that led to an estimated 79,000 survivors of Canada's residential school system suing the Canadian government. The settlement amounted to upwards of $5 billion. Chile approved class actions in 2004. The Chilean model is technically an opt-out issue class action followed by a compensatory stage which can be collective or individual. This means that the class action is designed to declare the defendant generally liable with erga omnes effects if and only if the defendant is found liable, and the declaratory judgment can be used then to pursue damages in the same procedure or in individual ones in different jurisdictions. If the latter is the case, the liability cannot be discussed but only the damages there under the Chilean procedural rules. One particular case works as the an opt-out class action for damages. This is the case when defendants can identify and compensate consumer directly, i.e. because it is their banking institution. In such cases the judge can skip the compensatory stage and order redress directly. Since 2005 more than 100 cases have been filed, mostly by Servicio Nacional del Consumidor, the Chilean Consumer Protection Agency. Salient cases have been the case Condec v. Banco Estado, and SERNAC v. La Polar France. Under French law, an association can represent the collective interests of consumers. However, each claimant must be individually named in the lawsuit. On January 4, 2005, President Chirac urged changes that would provide greater consumer protection. A draft bill was proposed in April 2006. Under the proposals, the court will be able to decide whether to allow an action brought by an association on behalf of consumers which must comprise at least two individuals for goods purchased under a standard contract. After such an action is brought, the association would be entitled to identify additional consumers for a one-month period. The court would determine the damages that must be awarded to the consumers who have opted into the proceedings, with damages limited to €2,000. Contingent fees for attorneys would be barred. The president of the French Supreme Court recently declared that class actions are inescapable. Nevertheless, the bill was withdrawn in January 2007 at the request of Minister of Health Xavier Bertrand following the change of majority in France in 2012. The new government is once more talking of introducing class actions into French law. The project of LOI Hamon of May 2013 aims to limit the class action to consumer and competition disputes. The law was passed on 17 March 2014. Germany. On November 1, 2005, Germany enacted the Act on Model Case Proceedings in Dispute under Capital Markets Law. Capital Markets Model Case Act, allowing sample proceedings to be brought before the courts in litigation arising from mass capital markets transactions. It does not apply to any other civil law proceeding. It is not like class actions in the United States. Claim to be brought in the name of an unknown group of claimants. The effects of the new law will be monitored over the next 5 years. It contains a sunset clause, and it will automatically cease to have effect on November 1, 2010, unless the legislature decides to prolong the law or extend it to other mass civil case proceedings. Italy has class action legislation. Consumer associations can file claims on behalf of groups of consumers to obtain judicial orders against corporations that cause injury or damage to consumers. These types of claims are increasing, and Italian courts have recently allowed them against banks that continue to apply compound interest on retail clients' current account overdrafts. The introduction of class actions is on the new government's agenda. On November 19, 2007, the Senato della Repubblica passed a class action law in Finanziaria 2008, a financial document for the economy management of the government. Now from 10 December 2007, in order of Italian legislation system, the law is before the House and has to be passed also by the Camera dei Deputati, the second house of Italian Parliament, to become an effective law in 2004. The Italian Parliament considered the introduction of a type of class action, specifically in the area of consumers' law. To date, no such law has been enacted, but scholars demonstrated that class actions azioni rappresentative do not contrast with Italian principles of civil procedure. Class action is regulated by Art 140 bis of the Italian Consumers Code and will be in force from 1 July 2009. India. Main article, Public Interest Litigation. See also, Constitution of India and Judiciary of India. Decisions of the Indian Supreme Court in the 1980s loosened strict locus standi requirements to permit the filing of suits on behalf of rights deprived sections of society by public-minded individuals or bodies, although not strictly class action litigation as it is understood in American law. Public interest litigation arose out of the wide powers of judicial review 32 granted to the Supreme Court of India and the various high courts under Article 32 and Article 226 of the Constitution of India, respectively. The sort of remedies sought from courts in public interest litigation go beyond mere award of damages to all affected groups and have sometimes controversially gone on to include court monitoring of the implementation of legislation and even the framing of guidelines in the absence of parliamentary legislation. However, this innovative jurisprudence did not help the victims of the Bhopal gas tragedy, who were unable to fully prosecute a class action litigation as understood in the American sense against Union Carbide due to procedural rules that would make such litigation impossible to conclude and unwieldy to carry out. Instead, the government of India exercised its right of parens patriae to appropriate all the claims of the victims and proceeded to litigate on their behalf, first in the New York courts and later, in the Indian courts. Ultimately, the matter was settled between the Union of India and Union Carbide in a settlement overseen by the Supreme Court of India for a sum of 760 crore rupees, 110 United States dollars. Dutch law allows associations verenigingen and foundations stichtingen to bring a so-called collective action on behalf of other persons, provided they can represent the interests of such persons according to their bylaws statute in section 3-305 a Dutch civil code. All types of actions are permitted, excluding a claim for monetary damages. Most class actions over the past decade have been in the field of securities fraud and financial services. The acting association or foundation may come to a collective settlement with the defendant. The settlement may also include of consumers. A number of groups already have the power to bring collective or class actions. Certain consumer associations, bodies legally constituted to defend the collective interest, and groups of injured parties. Recent changes to Spanish civil procedure rules include the introduction of a quasi-class action right for certain consumer associations to claim damages on behalf of unidentified classes of consumers. The rules require consumer associations to represent an adequate number of affected parties who have suffered the same harm. Also, any judgment made by the Spanish court will list the individual beneficiaries or, if that is not possible, conditions that need to be fulfilled for a party to benefit from a judgment. Switzerland. Swiss law does not allow for any form of class action. When the government proposed a new federal code of civil procedure in 2006, replacing the cantonal codes of civil procedure, it rejected the introduction of class actions, arguing that is alien to European legal thought to allow somebody to exercise rights on the behalf of a large number of people if these do not participate as parties in the action. Moreover, the class action is controversial even in its country of origin, the U.S., because it can result in significant procedural problems. Finally, the class action can be openly or discreetly abused. The sums sued for are usually enormous, so that the respondent can be forced to concede, if they do not want to face sudden huge indebtedness and insolvency, so-called legal blackmail. United Kingdom. The civil procedure rules of the courts of England and Wales came into force in 1999 and have provided for representative actions in limited circumstances under Part 196. These have not been much used, with only two reported cases at the court of first instance in the first 10 years after the civil procedure rules took effect. However, a sectoral mechanism was adopted by the Consumer Rights Act 2015. Taking effect on 1 October 2015 under the provisions therein, opt-in or opt-out collective procedures may be certified for breaches of competition law. This is currently the closest mechanism to a class action in England and Wales. See also Dukes v. Walmart, the largest civil rights class action lawsuit to date. List of class action lawsuits. Securities class action. Public interest litigation, a similar system adopted in India. Bill of Peace, an English predecessor to class actions. Collective redress, a similar legal framework currently under development in the European Union. Arbitration clause, a contract clause that attempts to prevent lawsuits by requiring arbitration in a private forum. Notes carat ABC class action. Wex Legal Dictionary, retrieved 5 May 2015. Carat Silver. Greenberg, Jessica, Gebeloff, Robert. 31 October 2015. Arbitration everywhere, stacking the deck of justice. The New York Times. ISSN. Carat Grondick, Randall J., Varnum LLP. April 5, 2013. Class action lawsuits target medical collections. The National Law Review, retrieved 10 May 2013. Jim Copeland, Class Actions. Carat AB, Do Class Actions Benefit Class Members? W. Winstitute for Legal Reformcom, retrieved 17 January 2016. Rochester, New York, Social Science Research Network. Carat Art 140 bis PDF, retrieved 4 October 2013. Justice M.B. Shah, 2 May 2002, Union of India vs. Association for Democratic Reforms. EU Law. The introduction of class actions in Belgium. Proposals to expand European class action law. Collective redress in Europe. George Parker, EU considers consumer class action. Financial Times, 4 March 2007. John Beisner and Charles Borden, On the Road to Litigation Abuse, The Continuing Export of U.S. Class Action and Antitrust Law. U.S. Chamber Institute for Legal Reform, October 2006. Mattel, Dessauter, European Class Action. German WM 12 2008.